brought to you by Penguin.
Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels, The Communist Manifesto, with an introduction and notes by Gareth Stedman Jones. Part 1. Introduction. 1. Preface. Through most of the 20th century, the importance of the Communist Manifesto was uncontested. It was important, not because of its intrinsic merits, but because of the brute facts of world politics. In the 20 or 30 years after 1950, millions in the Soviet Union, China, Cuba, and Eastern Europe lived under communist rule. Millions more, whether engaged in civil wars in Southern Africa, Latin America, and Southeast Asia, or in political struggles in France, Greece, Italy, or Portugal, lived in countries in which communism was a powerful and inescapable presence. In Western Europe, communism was rejected as unacceptably authoritarian. But strange though it now seems, until the 1960s, it continued to be identified with an image of ruthless and energetic modernity. At the time of the Soviet five-year plans in the 1930s, it had been thought to possess an answer to mass unemployment. Through to the 1970s, it was widely believed to have the most effective solutions to economic backwardness. In many parts of the Third World, national liberation and anti-colonial movements concocted their creeds from a mixture of Marxism and nationalism, while even in Northern and Western Europe, a blend of Keynesianism and moderate versions of socialist planning appeared to be in the ascendant. In Britain, in 1964, for example, the Prime Minister, Mr. Wilson, as champion of the forces of modernity, believed he had to produce a national plan to regenerate the country. Only in the United States, and even there, only after a sustained period of persecution in the McCarthy era, did the population appear immune to the appeal of socialism. Clearly, therefore, an understanding of the modern world appeared to require a knowledge of Marx, and Marx's message was most memorably set out in the Communist Manifesto. But in the 1980s and 1990s, the political landscape of this mid-20th century world was transformed beyond recognition. The fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989, the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1992, and the extinction of communist parties everywhere outside China and Southeast Asia brought to an abrupt end a Cold War that most had come to accept as part of the order of things. No one had anticipated that communism would make such a rapid and undignified exit from history. Socialist and social democratic parties had also been forced onto the defensive. From the time of the events in Paris in May 1968, libertarian and anti-authoritarian movements had emerged on both the left and on the right. The rise of a new and more aggressive laissez-faire conservatism, spearheaded by Mrs. Thatcher in Britain and President Reagan in the United States, brought to an end the post-Second World War consensus built upon exchange stability, full employment, and social security. At the same time, the electoral basis of social democracy began to break up as traditional industrial occupations throughout the developed world disappeared in the face of a shift of manufacture to the Third World. In addition, developments in electronics and information technology led to the downsizing of corporations, the casualization of office employment, and yet more shedding of manual labor. In the new era, a growing prosperity of the majority of wage earners in the advanced economies was accompanied by increasing insecurity and the emergence of an underclass lacking any useful function in the post-industrial economy. Traditional socialists and social democratic aspirations to shape the economy or to redistribute wealth were all but abandoned. The increase in female employment has made the language of the manifesto appear dated. Appeals for the unity of working men have all but ceased. The growth of more individualized political concerns and the proliferation of single-issue campaigns have made the ambition to turn the working class into a party appear incomprehensible. Belief in the possibility, or even the desirability, of a future communist society has become extinct. In this new era, the manifesto can no longer command automatic attention, and its importance needs to be thought out afresh. Will it become one of a very small number of political texts? Plato's Republic, Machiavelli's Prince, Hobbes's Leviathan, Rousseau's Social Contract may be others, that even centuries after their original composition still retain their power to shock? Or will it, like the communist movement it once inspired, shrink in importance until it is little more than an object of curiosity for specialists in the history of political thought? To this question, there is one simple answer. The manifesto will remain a classic, if only because its brief but still quite unsurpassed depiction of modern capitalism. Marx was the first to evoke the seemingly limitless powers of the modern economy and its truly global reach. He was the first to chart the staggering transformation produced in less than a century by the emergence of a world market and the unleashing of the unparalleled productive powers of modern industry. He also delineated the endlessly inchoate, incessantly restless, and unfinished character of modern capitalism as a phenomenon. He emphasized this inherent tendency to invent new needs and the means to satisfy them, its subversion of all inherited cultural practices and beliefs, its disregard of all boundaries, whether sacred or secular, its destabilization of every hallowed hierarchy, whether of ruler and ruled, man and woman, or parent and child, its turning of everything into an object for sale. In short, the manifesto sketches a vision of reality that at the start of a new millennium, and against a background of endless chatter about globalization and deregulation, looks as powerful and contemporary a picture of our own world as it might have appeared to those reading it in 1848. In the period before 1870, political economists were slow to recognize the transforming power of industrialization because they remained haunted by fears of overpopulation and the specter of diminishing returns. It was left to socialists in the 1830s and 1840s, particularly the followers of Robert Owen, as apostles of what was then called social science, to identify themselves with the prospect of abundance and the possibility of a society freed from scarcity. But these potentialities were identified with science and cooperation. They were not usually associated with the market, which was denounced as a system of unequal exchange, of the war against all, or of buying cheap and selling dear. From this position, it was easy to slip back into a nostalgia for a simpler society, with predictable expectations and fixed needs. What was unusual, if not unique, about the manifesto, and this is by no means true of all Marx's other writings, was its unflinchingly modernist vision, in which the capitalist world market was not simply identified with destabilization and exploitation, but also with the liberating power, the power to release people from backwardness and tradition-bound dependence. The continual process of innovation, the incessant invention of new needs, and the creation of new markets have not ceased since the time the manifesto was written. The tendency towards limitless expansion remains, even if it is now hindered by environmental dangers, as it once was by diminishing returns. Communism, as subsequent history was to prove, was not the answer to the contradictory tendencies at work in the world depicted by the manifesto. But whatever is said about the rest of the manifesto, its great achievement was to have built its theory upon a highly distinctive and strikingly novel vision of the modern world that, for all the immense changes of a century and a half, still remains visibly our own. The case for the historical importance of the manifesto is also powerful. For a century or more, its now seemingly extraordinary theory of history as a class struggle, leading inevitably towards the triumph of world communism, constituted a credo embraced by tens of thousands, sometimes hundreds of thousands, of adherents in every part of the world. Enunciated, not as a statement of principle or an expression of desire, but as a set of predictions, the formulations of the manifesto underpinned the creation of a worldwide labor movement in the last third of the 19th century and in the 20th century, fueled many of the political struggles and not a few of the wars that tore the world apart from 1917 to 1918.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.